Welcome to Thundercast, ThunderTech's podcast where we give you our take on what's new in marketing, what's cool, what's lame, and why you should care.
Hello, everyone, and welcome back to Thundercast, ThunderTech's regular podcast. I'm Craig Israel, creative director at ThunderTech, and I have two other people with me in the room today. You want to introduce yourselves?
Tom Valentino, communication specialist, back with you. And Craig, welcome back from vacation. You were looking tan and rested today.
Thank you. I think by tan you mean terribly pale, as usual, but thank you, nevertheless.
It's podcast. I can't tell. You'd be whatever you want on air.
That's true. For our listeners, I am a very handsome man.
It's growing an incredibly longer beard these days.
Yeah, so I was camping in the woods for a week, and I let the beard grow, and it's starting to reach a hobo phase, but I am enjoying it.
Very woodsy.
So the other voice that you hear is Jason Therrien, the president of ThunderTech.
Howdy.
Today we are going to talk about our Trends Summer Reader magazine. Now, Trends is something that we've been doing for a couple years now. We've put out a print edition at the end of the year to serve as a wrap-up of some marketing trends that we've either talked about or executed or just have started to experiment with. So that's been pretty successful. But this year, we did something different. We put out a mid-year edition, too. So, Jason, you want to talk about what was the genesis of us putting out the Trends Summer Reader.
Right. So the Summer Reader really came about in discussions probably the end of last year. And it was looking at our content marketing program and really just saying, all right, the winter annual trends book had done so well. We got such good feedback from it. It was a good lead nurture tool for us as well to get in front of people and educate them. Said, why only do it once a year? This just needed to be an evolution. So we tested it with the annual book. We're keeping the annual book. And then we did the summer reader edition and put a little different spin on it from the winter one as well.
So before we get too far, we should mention that you can get your hands on your own edition of the Trends Summer Reader. Download it, and you can follow along with the conversation. It's available right now on Apple iBooks, Google Playbooks, and you can download a digital PDF at trends.thundertech.com. Or if you really want to hold something in your hand, you can contact us through our website, and we'll send you a real physical thing. So the Trend Summer Reader, Tom, we've been talking a lot about journalism and marketing journalism. So this is us not just talking the talk, but taking our own advice, right?
Yeah, and one of the stories that we worked on for this, the fourth feature, we were looking at content marketing and how other organizations are finding success. Lincoln Electric creating a magazine. So I guess it was a little bit ironic that we were using a magazine of our own to talk about how other organizations are talking about magazines. But it was a really great opportunity just for us to kind of dive in and explore some stories. And I thought it was a really great platform to work with.
Yeah, so initial feedback has been pretty positive, right? That our customers and other people who have read it seem to enjoy the information we're putting out. Because like any good brand journalist, we're not putting this out as a hard sell, trying to sell our services directly, that we're really trying to educate people about a select few topics that seem to be hot in the industry right now.
Yeah, and I think there was a lot of content in there, and really the goal as we wrote it was finding and identifying the unifying themes that are applicable to organizations in just all different industries. While I wouldn't say necessarily, of course, that every marketing solution works for every business in every industry, I do think that certain solutions and certain pain points are very relatable across different sectors. One of the things that, just getting back again to the content marketing piece that I thought was really interesting, you know, Lincoln Electric focuses their efforts on welding. Then you've got a company like DeReese that's a distributor for the crafting industry, and yet they're both putting out great content to educate and inspire their audience. So you have two very different businesses targeting two very different audiences, but they still, at the end of the day, are taking the same tactic and putting their own spin on it.
So this year, The Summer Reader is a different format than what we've put out for the Trends book before. The Trends books, our previous Trend books, our end-of-the-year wrap-up, are a smaller, heavy stock book. But we made this purposely look like a magazine. So the thinking behind this was that it's summertime. You know, this is ideal beach reading. So it's a little larger format, a little lighter stock. We've purposely designed it to look like a magazine, like a Rolling Stone or Entertainment Weekly. So, Jason, have you got any feedback in general from clients that the format, does it work for them, not work for them?
Yeah, and this was done with a lot of thought up front. The annual Winter Trends one that starts the year off is more of a quicker read. Right, a lot of people, a lot of clients are in planning mode and just trying to keep an eye on things. It's not long, and we get right to the point of what we think are trends and why they should care. This one was a little longer form, told it, as Tom was saying, more of a journalistic perspective, interviewing our clients and telling others what they're doing. So it wasn't just our opinion, it was actually the application of these trends. And we thought from a literal format perspective that that storytelling was going to work better in a magazine format. And understanding it was the summer, this we would hope would sit on a desk a little longer. And I'd gotten that feedback and actually had visited a couple of clients and saw it on the corner of their desk. And so it's proving to hold weight.
Excellent. So whereas the end of the year trends book, we typically dive into about 10 trends and present them at a very high level. For the summer reader, we focused on four that really seemed to come to the forefront and go into a little more depth on that. So let's talk for a minute about the four that we chose and why we chose those.
Yeah. Why don't you jump into that, Tom?
Sure.
And I guess as background, right, you did all the interviewing. We'll obviously wind that into this.
Yeah, so for those who don't know, my background is in newspapers. I was a business writer, business editor for several years. And this project, getting to write the features for the Trend Summer Reader magazine, was kind of getting me back to what I had done in my previous part of my career. And the big four trends that we pulled from the trends book from last winter that we really wanted to dive into here were marketing automation, the digitization of certain business practices in the cloud, looking at the new and emerging options for paid digital media, and then, as we've referred to earlier, content marketing.
And I think those were good summations of, like Craig had said, about those 10 or so trends that we put out. We couldn't cover every one. This was the summer reader. We knew it would be a little lighter, since we didn't make this book 50, 60 pages long. I think it's 24 or so in here. So it's something you can still flip through, but it's not onerous. And that from a content marketing perspective, it's understanding audience, but it's also understanding where they may be at in the year. And we know our audience. You know, again, it's summer. They might take us to the beach, they may not, but they don't have a lot of time. So again, get to the point.
So as Jason said, we wanted to make sure that this didn't come across as a marketing textbook. You know, we purposely kept the articles a little more conversational, and one of them, we did a roundtable where it actually released it as previously as a podcast. You can go back into our archives and hear that for yourself, where we got some of our experts internally and sat them around a table moderated by you, Tom.
Yeah, we had three members of the staff here join me for the roundtable discussion, and I thought it was really interesting as we looked at the different aspects of the paid digital media world, whether it's the traditional ad buys, digital display, things along those lines, tied in with social media advertising, and then you've got search advertising as well, PPC and the like, and again, it was one of those instances where as we start seeing more options and smarter, more targeted approaches, the companies that are doing things really well and the clients that we're seeing have the best success are the ones who are able to tie in their efforts across those different platforms into one real cohesive advertising plan.
And again, taking our own advice, that we recorded the podcast, the roundtable. You used it for content that we put into the magazine, obviously. We released it as its own podcast. So embracing that COPE philosophy, where create once, publish everywhere.
COPE. I love it.
Yeah, so we were able to squeeze an additional podcast out of it. So
Yay.
It's a win-win.
One less piece of work. Yes. Well, I mean, that's practicing what we preach, right, too. I think that's important for us as an agency to do. And, you know, if we ask it of our clients, why wouldn't we ask it of ourselves? So speaking of some of these interviews and clients and experts that you talked to, Tom, I guess, you know, what were your takeaways that you would share with our audience today?
You know, I felt that it was really nice to see how the trends that we're looking at and the concepts that we presented back over the winter with the book are actually being executed, and the fact that these things really work. It all sounds great on paper, but how is this thing actually going to work for you when you put it into action? Are there actual demonstrable, measurable results? And I think we're absolutely seeing that. I know when we talk about the digitization in the cloud, one example, transport services, they went from a paper-based, simple inventory, sending their sales representatives out on the road, to being able to have a cloud-based system that's updating in real time. And it was really impacting sales for them. It was providing a much better experience for their customers, where they're now able to show a live inventory of the trailers that they have available, whereas before, that wasn't always necessarily going to be the most up-to-date if transactions are happening elsewhere. So you see the people that are using these tools, they're getting excited because they're like, hey, this is actually making my job easier. And it's paying off with great business results. I know Meyer Products, another company that we talked with, rolled out a very detailed and thorough marketing automation process. And one of the representatives that we talked to there said that the ability, the platforms that they're implementing, the ability to tie in their marketing and their sales teams and those efforts, tie them together, it's one of the biggest developments he's seen in 30 years in the industry.
Yeah. I really like that article too, because there's been so much hype around automation, and it wasn't an agency preaching it or the actual technology platforms preaching it. It was clients. In this case, a couple of clients that are actually in it or making plans to be in it. And you heard, I think, a lot of good recommendations about it. You know, stuff that maybe we can say, but, you know, again, we're coming from the agency side. But up here, I think that was very useful.
I would agree.
You know, on my behalf, I was really encouraged by the last article talking about brand journalism and these publications that some of our clients are putting out. It can be a hard sell to convince clients to undergo a marketing tactic that doesn't have a direct measurable impact. You know, not that these aren't measurable, but something as labor intensive as a publication. You know, we learned through our own efforts to build the Summer Reader. You know, Tom did the interviews, did the actual writing. You know, I had a designer on my team design it. We had to print it, translate it into ebooks. You know, all told, you know, a lot of man hours go into something like this, and it can be difficult to draw a direct line from this is how much we spent internally, and this was the return on investment. But it's nice to see clients willing to embrace this long game, where they know that if they position themselves as experts, position themselves as an informational source and not just a vendor, that clients appreciate that education and come back again and again.
Yeah, I think that was really interesting. That was kind of the meta part of interviewing on the content marketing article, people that were creating magazines in a magazine from an agency that believes in magazines as far as our content marketing. And I guess, you know, to Craig's point, the energy that goes in it, we're seeing more clients, you know, really embrace the publishing side of their marketing and consider publications, right? Sometimes there are different forms, magazines, sometimes they're online, offline, sometimes there's booklets, et cetera. But, you know, could you speak to that, just where you think that's going? And Craig, from your point of view, from a creative standpoint, I think the long game piece was excellent commentary there.
Well, I think, as you had mentioned, Jason, that there are a lot of different ways that you can deliver that content and magazines have been the one option that have been thrown around here. But I mean, you can have a really great blog. You can have a great email newsletter. You could be delivering your message through a video series on your YouTube channel, or like we're doing right now, you can put together a good quality podcast. We're trying to put together a quality podcast.
I hope so.
But,
right?
Jerry's still out.
Yeah.
We'll let you listeners be the judge on that one. Right. But there are a lot of different options. And I think, as we've kind of talked on this series before, there are more tools than ever that are available. And I think there's a lot of migration for journalists heading out of the traditional newsroom and going to work for companies and bringing those skills and that experience and applying those tactics to the business world. And companies really have a great opportunity right now to take ownership of their story.
You know, from a creative standpoint, I'm encouraged when brands want to create things in the real world. Everybody talks about online and websites and emails and digital, and all that stuff has its place and it's very important. But I have a soft spot in my heart for real world things, something you can hold in your hand. So it's great to see that all the doomsayers saying that print is dead, that there is no place for printed physical things anymore. We've seen an upturn lately on clients who have printed real world things like the Trend Summer Reader or their own publications. So I love it that print is still a viable option and it becomes a really important part of the overall marketing mix.
But doesn't so much of this come back to understanding your audience, right? I mean, will they react to print, right? And I think everybody still has things in the physical world, but some personas may react better to it.
Absolutely, and that's why, like I said, it's part of the mix. So even the Trend Summer Reader, yeah, we have this beautiful book that you can hold in your hands, but it's also an ebook, it's a PDF, you can really consume it however you want. And I think that's your point. That's the important thing, is that you present that information and you make it flexible enough for customers to consume however they best want.
Craig, I got a question for you in terms of the actual print edition. This was conceived as a spin-off piece from the book that we did last winter. As we started coming up with the look and feel of this, what was your philosophy in terms of making this a publication that would really stand out and have that summer feel while still being true to the marketing trends brand that we've really established with the book that comes out?
Yeah, so we almost established it as its own sub brand within the overall trends brand. And as you said, it was very purposeful that it was a little different. We thought it would be a little onerous to give a dense, heavy book to people that might be in a hurry in summer when attention is really pulled 100 different ways. So we presented it as kind of light beach reading, right? The big format. It stays true to the Trends brand. I mean, the Trends brand is an offshoot of the ThunderTech brand. So obviously our brand colors and our logo and our tagline, those things are still present. I think the tone of voice is still consistent with what we say with our brand and the overall Trends book. But overall, we tried to make it a little lighter, airier, seem a little friendlier, so that the barrier to entry wasn't very high. So that if you were to flip it open anywhere, you have bright colors, you know, a lot of white space that pull you in instead of you opening up and looking like a wall of text that you would say, I don't have time to read this. Okay, Trend Summer Reader, final thoughts?
I think this was a really interesting project to work on. It was really enjoyable getting to talk with clients and really hear their success stories. I hope that we were able to present them in a way that's relatable for readers and those that work in all kinds of different industries, and they can kind of take away from that, hey, there are a lot of people in my shoes, and there are ways to find success with the challenges that I'm facing, and maybe this is a good tactic for me to try going forward.
I'm glad that it continued along our, you know, to support our principle of education for clients. certainly there to keep our brand in front of our audience, but really, first and foremost, we can educate, we build trust. Everything else kind of follows that. But the feedback I've gotten, I think coming at it from the peer perspective versus the agency side, I hope got across and how much we believe, again, in that long tail view that Craig had talked about, and really brand journalism approach that Tom and his team have been championing. So I'm looking forward to next year's. Again, feedback we got on it was so good. It's a beautiful piece, and it turned out well digitally too.
Absolutely. That's worth mentioning that the, again, it's available. You can get your own copy right now on Apple iBooks, Google Play Books, and the ebook edition is enhanced so that there's some fun animations and some fun interactions that obviously you can't get in the print static piece. But if you're looking for print, you can do it, print it out right now, trends.thundertech.com, and you can enjoy it at your leisure. So that's it for Thundercast. As always, you can subscribe to us on iTunes and Stitcher or wherever you purchase your fine podcast. If you have a question or a topic you'd like to hear in the future, you can email us at thundercast@thundertech.com. Thanks for listening.